Hachette Audio presents Edison's Ghosts, the Untold Weirdness of History's Greatest Geniuses, written by Katie Spalding, read by Susie Riddell.
Introduction. As Albert Einstein almost certainly never said, everyone is a genius. But if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will live its whole life believing that it is stupid. The message behind it is clear. Everyone has different strengths, and you shouldn't feel bad that you have no idea how C stands for speed of light, or why multiplying it by M will give you E, because there's probably a bunch of stuff you can do that Einstein couldn't. It's kind of ironic that whoever first came up with this saying chose Einstein as its supposed progenitor. Because in fish terms, the man who gave the world the theories of special and general relativity, rewriting the very laws of physics of the universe, was dumb as a box of rocks. Let me explain. Imagine you're a fish, living in the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of Long Island in the late 1930s. There you are, swimming along with all your fishy pals, minding your fishy business, when suddenly in bursts some huge hairy beast out of the sky, splashing around, making a huge scene and freaking everybody out with its cries of, "Help! Help! I can't swim! I'm going to drown!" Which you don't even understand because, you know, you're a fish. And now imagine that's the sixth time that's happened this week. At some point, you're going to stop swimming away in fear from this wild-haired intruder and start trying to put it out of its obvious misery. I guess what I'm saying is, it's amazing that Einstein was never murdered by a bunch of pissed-off cod. Because despite being probably the guy most people in the West would associate with the word genius, he never learned to swim. Now, I'm not here to tell you that's some kind of fatal personality flaw. Plenty of perfectly lovely people can't swim. But those people don't tend to spend their summers pursuing a hobby where an inability to swim can literally result in your death. Not so with Einstein, who was an enthusiastic and objectively fucking terrible ocean sailor, and whose reputation in the hamlet of Cutchogue, New York, is to this day less epoch-defining physicist and more public nuisance who wouldn't stop forcing us all to jump in the sea and save him. See, the flip side of everyone is brilliant in their own way is the equally true everyone is an idiot. And that seems to be particularly true when we talk about the people traditionally held up as geniuses. Maybe it's just the apparent contrast between what we expect from these figures and what we get. For example, it probably wouldn't be totally surprising to learn that, say, Chris, the kid you went to school with who won the Gave the Most Teachers a Mental Breakdown award at prom, is now being sued for failing to deliver on some construction work. But that's just not the sort of behaviour you'd expect from Leonardo da Vinci. He's meant to be, you know, better than us. Then again, they say we only use 10% of our brains at any one time, which just goes to show how much they know about neuroscience. But really, should we expect people who are busy literally changing the world to also be able to concentrate on more prosaic things, like contract law and swimming lessons? The germ of the idea for this project came to me a few years ago, in the aftermath of a total solar eclipse. I was in Durham at the time. I was about halfway through my maths PhD, and the university was holding its annual summer mathematical symposium, a wonderful opportunity for students and professors to meet, exchange ideas, collaborate, and, most importantly, get ludicrously drunk. You might not believe it, but there are very few people in my experience who can party harder than a bunch of professional mathematicians. The eclipse was a pretty amazing sight. I remember everyone stepping out of whichever seminar was going on at the time to watch as the sun disappeared behind the moon for a few precious seconds. Evidently, awe-inspiring cosmological phenomena are more interesting than the finer points of Tyche Müller theory for some people. Takes all sorts, I suppose. But it wasn't the eclipse itself that people were talking and reading and memeing about in the following days. What had caught the imagination of the world at large wasn't the grand majesty of nature, but the folly of man. Specifically, a man named President Donald J. Trump. Despite this man having access to resources like Secret Service agents dedicated to keeping him safe, and top government scientists and advisers, and presumably at least a primary school level education, the publicity shots that came out of the White House that year to commemorate the eclipse showed Trump very clearly squinting, bare-eyed, right up at the sun. Immediately, people started asking the obvious question: was this man really so stupid as to stare directly at the sun? And, I mean, yes, he was. But it led me to think of someone else. Because you know who else was that stupid? Isaac Newton. Yes, that Newton. The guy with the apple, who we all, unquestioningly, think of as one of history's greatest geniuses. In fact, Newton arguably outdid Trump by several levels of stupidity. He didn't just look at the sun without eye protection. He put that famously big and inventive brain to work, setting up the precise scenario that would cause the maximum damage to his eyes possible. The result? 3 days of blindness, and what is possibly the most revolutionary investigation into light and optics ever written. Now, as far as I'm aware, Donald Trump has not yet given the world an epoch-defining scientific treatise. Maybe one day he will, and staring directly at the sun will come to be seen as just one of those things geniuses do, like playing the violin or getting brained by apples. But for me, the fact that my friends' disbelieving cries of "Who the fuck doesn't know not to stare directly at the sun?" could be smugly replied to with "Isaac Newton, actually," was just incredibly funny. And since there's only so many times you can tell your friends how ignorant they are before they start actively avoiding you, and Trump didn't seem likely to go ocean sailing anytime soon, I decided to write it all down. Normally, biographies of the great and the good tend to hide these weird little ventures of their subjects in a footnote or some throwaway sentence, something your eyes will skip over while you digest the more general point of how amazing they were. Surely, if only for symmetry's sake, there should be at least one book out there that reverses that rule, that tells you how dumb and relatable they were, and maybe imparts some incidental lesson about their achievements. In general, I think there are two kinds of these weirdo geniuses. The first group are the Mozarts and Confuciuses of history. People who, had they not been objectively incredible at what they did, would probably have gone down in history as "that pervert from Getreidegasse" or "some ugly janitor who kept asking if you wanted to read his history books." They're the lucky bastards, basically. The ones who got away with foibles us mere mortals would be forced to save for our anonymous Tumblr accounts. The other kind are perhaps more interesting. These are people like Marie Curie or the aforementioned Leonardo da Vinci, the ones whose shortcomings were pretty tightly interwoven with their accomplishments. Take away Leonardo's flighty imagination and you'd get, what? A guy who was much better at delivering on contracts, sure, but probably not the Mona Lisa. And while it's easy, as a modern reader, to scoff at Curie's habit of carrying radioactive elements around in her pockets and bare hands, you have to admit, if she wasn't the kind of woman willing to handle warm, glowing lumps of metal while watching her skin inexplicably burn off in real time because of it, then she wouldn't have been the kind of woman who could discover radium. So who counts? After all, we've all done stupid things now and then. I myself once accidentally swallowed a bunch of that stuff you get inside a glow stick, and inexplicably, nobody gave me a Nobel Prize for it. Clearly, just being an idiot isn't enough. But as I increasingly found while compiling stories of humanity's brightest and best, neither is just being a genius. I want you to try something for me. Type geniuses into a search engine and see what comes up. I'm going to go out on a limb here and guess you got, among all the definitions and photos of Einstein, a lot of links to biographies of people like Newton, or Stephen Hawking, or Terry Tao, or even Jackie Chan, depending on the tastes of whoever compiled the list. If you haven't noticed a problem there, then try searching for female geniuses instead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.